Myco heroes will interview you. A mycological heroes to tell us your point of view. On fungi.
Coming up on this episode.
Something, and it's coconut.
That's like usually given another name. That's a sort of nitric smell. It's sharp, isn't it? Okay. The iodoform smell isn't sharp.
Yeah, I need to learn too.
Oh, if you play it all but all, you've smashed it. You beat the mycologist.
Well, not only are they beautiful and fascinating, they're also incredibly important and useful.
That's for you.
Well, I'm very honoured.
What's that? It's a failure is what that is. I mean, I can't have you on camera as a failure. What am I going to do? Give you a different mushroom.
Name that fungus.
Tar spot.
I'm going to just go and throw products at you. I'm sure shampoo's one.
Oh, yoo-hoo! And welcome. Thanks for joining me. I'm very excited today because it's the first ever episode of Meet the Myco Hero. So I'm in super company, which is unusual for me. Well, I'm always in the company of mushrooms or fungi, but today it's the human form. And that form takes the shape of wonderful, esteemed mycologist, Irene Ridge. Well, first of all, thanks for inviting me into your home, Irene.
You're very welcome.
Thank you very much indeed. So, do you know what? Let's start at the beginning. How did fungi start for you? Where did it all begin?
I can't honestly remember, but it was sometime as a teenager when I used to draw fungi. I found some of the old drawings.
Right. So what made you want to draw them? Were you out finding them out and about?
I must have been.
But yeah. You don't recall that?
No memory.
And it's funny you should say that because I've spoken to a few people recently and I'm included in that. That as an adult and even as a young man who always played in the woods, I don't ever remember seeing fungi. I don't remember them being on my radar at all. And yet only now as someone who's become interested in fungi do I actually spot them anywhere.
It was always the big, colourful ones you spotted.
Yeah, okay, yeah. Okay. And then when did it become something that actually was a conscious thing? When did you actually become serious in your life?
I must have been about 30 when I got a decent camera. Mm-hmm. And we used to go on holiday to a remote cottage on the edge of Exmoor. Mm-hmm. And I'd spend all my time wandering about in the woods and finding fungi.
Right. Okay.
And photographing them because they don't move.
Oh, yeah, okay.
And also I had the one book that you could use in those days, Langer and Horror. That was the only popular fungus book. And if a fungus wasn't in Langer and Horror, but basically it didn't exist. So I used to spend my evenings by lamplight, with no electricity there, identifying these fungi. And
wow, isn't that wonderful? And so how did you feel about something that you couldn't pin down in the book? Did you think that you hadn't got it right because you couldn't place it in the book? Or did you know that there was some that didn't exist in that book?
I think both, actually.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, but I certainly knew there were more than were in that book.
Yeah.
But I hadn't got any other books or keys.
Back then, do you know how many were in that book? Because I know, obviously, resources were more limited back a little bit.
I can't remember. Quite a lot.
Okay.
Quite a lot. Mm. And I wasn't into identifying the small, brown, anonymous fungi, which, you know, I
little
love
brown
now.
Jobs, yeah.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Yeah. But even so, it was the most striking-looking ones that you would go for.
Well, they can be away in that, can't they? Because they're the ones that will catch your eye.
Like, yeah.
As we've just acknowledged, you might not notice fungi out and about, but people often can recognise, for instance, Figaric.
Yes, and the russulas, the brittle gills.
Yeah, yeah.
But I always used to go, you see, mainly on the colour. And that's no good. The colour is very variable.
Yes.
So I misidentify most of them, I think.
Okay, it's all part of that learning curve, though, isn't it? All part of that learning curve. And even now, russulas are really tricky.
They are not easy. They're not easy. No, you have to be very careful and use a good key,
yeah,
really.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, that's a very good piece of advice. So in terms of your history of profession, you studied botany, am I right?
Yes, I did, yes.
Did that include fungi, then?
Yes, there were some fungi in the course because in those days people regarded fungi as plants. And of course, now we know they're not plants.
No. Mm.
They're more like animals. Mm. But yes, they were in the course.
Right, yeah. I see, okay. How are they more like animals?
Well, like animals, they need food. The only thing is they don't take the food into their bodies as we do. They digest it outside their bodies.
It's like an external stomach, isn't it?
They exude enzymes.
Right.
And then that becomes soluble, and then it enters the fungus.
Right.
In the form of all those little threads that form fungi.
Yes.
Going through the soil.
Yeah, okay.
And also they have various sort of biochemical features that make them more like animals.
Okay.
Like their cell walls are made largely of chitin.
Yes, okay.
And that's the stuff that you get around the hard part of insects.
Yeah, that's right, isn't it? Okay, yeah,
yeah,
okay.
That's a couple of things, and there are others.
Super. And, of course, they can't photosynthesize. Is that right?
That's why they need food.
Yeah.
They can't make their own food as green plants can.
That's the way that green plants would, yeah. Mm. Brilliant answer. So you were a lecturer at university. Was it Open University?
Yes, I went there in 1972, right near the beginning of the Open University, when I was a lecturer in biology and basically dealt with nearly anything to do with plants and then, you know, a huge range of subjects that we covered.
During the course of these years, am I right in thinking you did some research papers on fungi?
I did some research on fungi towards the end. It was mostly plants, but yes, I did one project where we were looking at decomposing straw for inhibiting algae and whether or not fungi were involved. And I had a research student who worked on that. And then later on I was working with another postdoctoral researcher and she was looking at some mycorrhizal fungi.
Okay.
That helped to... In this case, they were helping to withstand heavy metal tolerance. They were making the plants that they were linked up to tolerant of metals.
And is it a fungus, as in, does it take a mushroom shape? Would I know it? Would I have heard of this mushroom or fungus?
You wouldn't know, no.
One of those more obscure ones that I wouldn't...
I'm afraid so, yes.
Okay, no common names there then.
No.
Speaking of the mushrooms that I do know about, which is quite a limited window, tell me, Irene, what's your favourite... I tell you what, let's say favourite genus. What's your favourite family? Have you got...
Well, I suppose... I mean, it's hard to say. I suppose I'd say, firstly, the earth tongues, Geoglossum.
Yeah, fab.
Which, I'm very also fond of Mycena, the bonnets.
Yes, OK.
The bonnets, they're nice little things.
There's a lot of interesting smells for Mycena, isn't there? Am I right in thinking that can just be a lovely key feature? When you think of all the things that you need to pool your knowledge to... pin down the identification of a mushroom. Mycena have a few funky smells.
They do, yes. Some of them smell, it's described as an iodoform smell, and I usually say it's a bit like hospitals or sort of antiseptic.
Yes,
it's a funny smell.
Would chlorine come under that? Because I'm sure I got one the other day that smelled like a swimming pool, the local baths.
That's usually given another name. That's a sort of nitric smell. It's sharp, isn't it?
Okay.
The iodoform smell isn't sharp.
Yeah, I need to learn too. See, I've got that now. I won't forget that one.
And then there are some that smell like potatoes, raw potatoes.
Oh, fab.
Or radish.
And that's in Mycena?
Yes,
yeah, okay,
it's in Mycena.
Oh, fab. Lovely. A bit of microscope work involved for Mycena?
Yes, very much so.
I was going to say.
Yeah, a lot of them are very similar.
The trouble is I do a lot of this. I see them and they're beautiful things, but I think, oh, that's so small. Anything I could do on a macro level, you know, pleases me, because there's this snapping bonnet, isn't there, where it makes an audible snap?
Yes, yes, if it's nice and fresh.
Okay, all right, we'll look for that.
And there are some that produce a sort of latex, a milk. That's very helpful, too.
Yeah, okay, different colours, or...?
Yes, there's one that produces a white milk, and then there are quite a few that produce a red or an orangey sort of
milk. They're on my hit list now, Irene.
Oh, yeah.
This is it, I'm out there, I'm going to be looking for those.
Yeah.
It's a difficult one to answer, but I've got to ask, what's your favourite fungus you've ever found? You know, what made you the most excited? Were you just like, yeah?
God, really difficult. Almost any fungus that you find that looks fresh and perfect and beautiful gives you a considerable thrill.
I agree. I totally agree. That's a very diplomatic, but it's an honest answer because... I know I have a friend who asks me every year, you know, what's on your radar this year? What would you really like to find? And I genuinely don't mind. I don't mind as long as I find new things as well, because that's always the excitement part. The thrill is, I've not missed this before.
Yeah.
I know, what could this be? And then you start applying all those things, the books you've read and the pictures you've seen. Well, let's try this one then, because I'm still going to try and pin you down for one. What's the most exciting recent find? Can you think of something recently where you thought, oh, I'm good at that's good?
Well, recently we were out and we found some very fine specimens of one of the saddle fungi, Helvella lacunosa, the grey saddle. And they were very, very beautiful. And I do think they're stunning fungi.
They're
actually
a beautiful one, aren't they?
They're really
nice. They're amazing. And the contortions and the whole shapes. Yeah, I love those. Yeah.
and really fine boleets. You know, when you find a really, they give you quite a thrill when
you see a really lovely boleet,
even whether or not you can eat it. It doesn't matter.
No, it doesn't. Well, they're just, someone describes them as homely shapes, and I just think, yeah, these good, solid, homely shapes.
Yes.
I wish I could reference who it was, but yeah. We're both quite passionate about outreach. You taught me a lot of that, Irene. I've not mentioned, of course, that you're the chair of the Northwest Fungus Group. For how many years have you been doing that for?
Not terribly sure. I think it's since about 2005.
Oh, yeah, that's
quite a
good
long
run.
Time.
And what would you, what are you particularly proud of that's happened for the Northwest Fungus Group in that time?
We've still got a good, lively committee that runs things, with people doing lots of things.
Yes, they do.
Which I think is great.
Give us a few samples of those things that go on for people who don't know that these fungus groups that exist across the country, what kind of things might you be involved in?
Well, they run regular forays, mm-hmm. fungus parties, when you go out and you look for fungi to identify them.
Which is where I've learnt a lot of my craft.
Yes.
Thank you very much for that.
And we run special ones to help beginners.
Mm-hmm.
We sometimes run workshops to help beginners and workshops to help people improve their knowledge.
Yeah.
You know, this particular genus.
Microscope workshops too, don't you?
Yes, we do a microscope workshop most years.
That's fab.
We try and do, and we have one of our members who's been very active here, well, including you, outreach activities, trying to, you know, run forays for other people. Give talks,
yeah.
That sort of thing, so that you try and tell people about fungi and how wonderful they are and how important they are.
Well, this leads me perfectly to one of my final questions, which is, I would love to know, why do you think people should know more about fungi?
Well, not only are they beautiful and fascinating, they're also incredibly important and useful. They're enormously important in industry, in medicine, in all sorts of different ways, from making coffee to producing antibiotics.
See, it's interesting. You've named, two of the three things there are an area I'd never think about. I'm always talking about the natural world, that, you know, they're essential to our existence. You know, no fungi, no forests, no forest, no future. That's my little one it's not mine. That someone showed me that. But I always think about the natural world. But like you say, in industry, was the first thing you said there.
And that's the other thing, though. As you rightly said, they are vital for maintaining nature, really. They're the crucial decomposers of particularly wood.
Yes.
And the other thing is that they are enormously helpful. These mycorrhizal fungi, they're the ones that help nearly all plants, but the ones we know about most are the ones that help trees.
Yep.
To get enough mineral nutrients from the soil and to live. And a lot of these trees particularly, they won't thrive at all unless they've got appropriate fungi.
So other industries are outcomes that fungi are responsible for that people might not realise?
Well, fungi make all these enzymes and they're widely used in industry.
Right.
And they, of course, perhaps one of the biggest of all, is alcohol.
Yeast.
A fungus.
Yes.
Bread making, brewing,
yeah.
Wine making, they all depend on fungi.
Yes. So they're really important for many people.
They are.
chocolate?
Yes, I can't remember how fungi are involved in making chocolate.
I'm going to just go and throw products at you. I'm sure shampoo's one. Isn't shampoo? There's something to do with shampoo.
There might be, I can't remember.
That's one for you to research at home, that's one for the viewer. See if I'm right. And the final question, Irene, and one that's very important to me in the whole of this interview process, is, are you willing to play some games with me?
For you, Ali.
Thank you very much. OK, and don't worry, you get to play along at home too with some of these. Come on, let's play games! So this game is called Zoom, and I want it to be an opportunity for you to play along at home. So, Irene, what I'm going to do, as you can see, I've got a laptop. Don't look yet, that would be cheating. I can't imagine you're a cheating type. I've got a very close-up, zoomed-in image. You see where I've got the name from? Of a mushroom or a fungus. And I'm very slowly going to zoom backwards like that. And as soon as you think you know what this mushroom is, or fungus, shout it out, Irene, OK? And we'll be counting the seconds. I've got a crew member who's got a timer now. He's going to time you, and you see how many seconds it takes to identify the fungus in our first ever game of Zoom!
Zoom!
On the mushroom or fungus.
Ready with the timer? And go. Okay, you can look now, Irene.
Well, it looks like the top of a stem of a fungus on the edge of its cap, and there's leaves behind, and it's a brown one, and it's looking...
Oh, no, I'm giving you a really hard one for your first game. I thought I'd give you an easy one. I might be wrong. I might have given you a horrible stinker.
So what's that? It's a failure is what that is. I mean, I can't have you on camera as a failure. What am I going to do?
Give you a different mushroom.
I can't tell you off the top of my head.
Awful.
I was going to say a rushley, but it's not. It's got a ribbed stem.
No, so. Yeah, look at me. Watch this now.
Look at this streaked stem here and that really hard, like, ruffled conker-like cap.
Or if you're playing home at home, you've smashed it. You've beat the mycologist.
A tricholoma?
Oh, do you know what it is? It's the deer shield. You know, young
one.
It's
not on wood, is it?
Well, it's buried a thing. I've made it hard because it's buried, haven't I?
Look at this.
But I don't regard the deer shield as having a stripy stem like that.
Well, I might be wrong. No. I can't believe I'm sat here.
It doesn't look like a deer shield to me.
Can you believe it? Now, I don't want to come out looking foolish, but I'd rather it's me than you.
I'm sure you're right.
Irene,
I'm
I tell
sure
you
right.
what.
Pink spored.
Yeah, yeah. Right. Well, I kept hold of it because that young state, it's very white, tight gills, isn't it?
Yeah, they are white then, yes.
Well, after all that controversy, let's leave it behind us and move on to round two.
Are you ready for your next one?
Try.
I feel like I've made... It might not be any easier. Maybe I'm right. I'll have to find some of these if this doesn't go to plan. Are we ready, Irene?
Okay.
Ready on the timer? Here we go. In 3, 2, 1... Zoom! Going the wrong way.
Looks like it could be... I was going to say the gills. No, it's going to be an ink cap. It's going to be a parasola. It looks like parasola leucephala, something like that.
I'll take it. Stop!
15 seconds.
Brilliant. I know it's the pleated ink cap, but I won't know what its proper name is. There you go. There's several pleated ink caps.
Yeah.
That puts me straight back in my place, doesn't it? Do you see what happened there? I've come in with my common names and all, it'll be that. And there's several. See, that's proper mycology.
Round three of Zoom. Ready on the clock?
Edge of a cap. A big fungus. Oh, this is looking like a bolete, yes. In fact, it looks like a seps.
Ta-da!
Yay!
Smashed it. Brilliant.
But it's edulous. Beautiful, fabulous. Isn't it?
It's a gorgeous one, that. A real chunky monkey.
Blah. Did you eat it?
I left that one where it was, actually, to see. I was studying the growth rate. I thought, I'll come back in a week. It had gone off by then.
It looks almost like two fused. You know, can you see?
Mm.
Two stems.
Oh, this here?
Yeah, and a very wide cap, which is not typical. I think it's two that have grown together.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah.
I didn't take that on board, and maybe that's why it's so chunky, learning all the time. You see why I enjoy this company. It's very good.
That's the end of that game. That's the end of Zoom. Oh, welcome to the Travelator.
Travelator!
The name of this game is that lots of fungi will travel along the Travelator, and our esteemed mycologists will try and guess and name them as they go past. You can play at home too. Here we go. 3, 2, 1, you're off.
Name that fungus.
Tar spot. Honey fungus.
Very good. Oh, we're going to have to go faster. This is too easy.
Foliota squarosa.
Next one. Tricky one.
Clitus cybe, possibly. If it went pink, Miller. Oh, you've got a two there. Helvella lacunosa, and it looks like... and that's false chanterelle. Oh, that looks like a suillus.
They're from your garden.
That looks like Lactarius glyceosmos, turkey. That's a jelly ear. That looks like a tiny little lepiota.
Woo! And stop! And what about you? Who are your myco heroes? Do you have people who've inspired you along your journey, Karen?
Oh, yes. Well, I mean, there's dear Geoffrey Kibbe, who is now our Northwest Fungus Group president, but he's a wonderful mycologist and he's written all these keys and books.
He's very approachable, I found, as well, you know, because he's there online answering people's questions. He's very,
very kind,
good like that. Yeah.
Very approachable man. And then Bruce Ing, who was our president before Geoffrey.
All the big hitters at the Northwest Fungus Group.
Yeah, that's right. We were very lucky indeed. And he's now moved up to Scotland.
Okay.
But he's a wonderful mycologist and he specialises in slime molds, which are actually not fungus.
Yeah, that's right. And what about your formative years? You know, when you were learning yourself, was there anybody else actually during your earlier years?
John Burnett. I did some research with John Burnett for a time. I spent nearly 2 years working with him.
Okay.
looking at the cell walls of Phytophthora. Now, these are the things that cause potato blight and all sorts of dreadful things, but they're actually not fungi.
Right.
This is the awful thing. At the time, we didn't know. We thought they were fungi. But John Burnett was a wonderful mycologist with a fantastic memory. And then before him, C.T. Ingold, whom I didn't know, but he wrote these wonderful books about spore dispersal.
Oh, yeah.
And I remember seeing him at a BMS meeting, getting a medal, and he was in his 90s then.
Oh,
still going.
Wonderful.
Still going, yeah.
Oh, that's fabulous. Here we go. So, come on then, what have we got here then?
Well, this has been coming up here under this cedar tree for a good few years, and it's a club fungus called Clavulina rugosa.
Lovely
so,
stuff.
So I can pick one up for you. You can see it's all sort of wrinkly.
Yeah, I think it's the wrinkled club as I would know it, because I'm not very good at Latin.
I think it might well be.
Yeah.
I'm not so hot on the common names.
Although a troop, they're quite a solitary. They come up, they're not.
Yes,
it's not like a coral as such. This is a club, not a coral.
It's not a sort of group fungus.
Yeah.
It is a little bit, it's not exactly branched, is it?
You get a little bit sometimes at the top.
Just a bit
there,
at the top,
you?
Yeah, okay. That's right.
Well, I spy fungi.
Oh, yes, that's the brown birch bolete, Lexinum.
And there's the birch.
Oh, that's right, there's the birch.
Now, this is what I think.
Yes, this is the coconut milk cap.
Yes, beautiful.
So what you've got to do with this is you've got to see the milk. So
I can see already there, the latex.
Oh, yeah, white milk, and you've got to smell it.
Well, this is the big one. This is the one that people can't believe until you show them. Just, it's sun cream and it's coconut. Coconut.
Perfect, it really is.
Well, it's not over yet. This is the moment you've been waiting for, I'm sure, Irene. It's time for the leaderboard. Let's see where you stand in our mycologist table league of results. Here we go, thank you. Here it is, the leaderboard's arrived. And Irene, I'm delighted to tell you, with your results from your Travelator and other games, you've gone straight in at the top spot. You are our leading mycologist, Irene Ridge. Give a round of applause. Very good.
I don't think I'll stay there very
long. Oh, listen. Oh, you're top of the shop right now. Let's enjoy the moment. It's not over yet either. Come on in. I've got a little award for you, Irene. Thank you. It's covering with the teeth. Lovely stuff. Thank you. Here it is. A special award that I made there for you because you're my Myco hero, Irene.
Oh.
Irene Ridge 2018. Thank you very much, Irene, for all that you've done for me.
Oh, thank you so much.
And for taking me under your wing so well. That's for you.
Well, I'm very honoured.
No, I am. Thank you, Irene. Irene Ridge. Our Myco hero. Do you know why it doesn't end there? I'm going to keep going. Look at this. Oh, hang on. I've got a bolete in that pocket. This is what I came in here for. Last thing here is a little badge. This is the moment you might want to get a close-up. She might shed a tear for this big moment. It's a little badge with my face on it. You get to choose the colour. White, orange, green, or pink.
Oh, I'll have the green.
And it says, what does it say? Read it out for the camera.
It says, I found fungi with the fungi guy.
Yes, she did. Thank you, Irene. Hey, is your day made now?
Absolutely made.
Fabulous.
Absolutely made.
Thank you so much, Irene. What a pleasure.
A pleasure.
Thanks, guys, for joining us. Let's hope there's an episode 2.